not having the board meeting this month, so we will not be having the board meeting this month, but we will have our normal schedule on Wednesday night, and that means at 6 o'clock, we invite you to join us for a family night dinner. We're having a light dinner this week. Mary's the cook. We're going to be having chicken stew and sandwiches, and I'm assuming we'll have dessert, because the pastor needs dessert if you're going to have sandwiches. And so we invite you to come and be a part of that. At 6:30, you can join us in the upper room at the pastor's study for an opportunity to pray and lift other people in prayer. And then at 7 o'clock, we'll have our midweek life lesson and praise and worship. And I'm going to be finishing that mini-series that I'm doing on how to have stress-free living, especially during the holidays. I shared 4 secrets to stress-free living last week. I'm going to be sharing 4 more. And then we're going to take 2 weeks off. We always take 2 weeks off during the Christmas and New Year's vacation time. We will not be meeting on the day after Christmas and the day after New Year's, but we will return to our regular schedule on Wednesday night on January the 9th, and I'll be starting a new series called the Be Happy Attitudes for 2013. I stole that title from Robert Shula, and I'm going to be talking about the 8 wonderful statements you find at the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount of Jesus. And so we invite you to be here for that when we start the new year. Also, want you to know that the choir is not meeting until January the 3rd. And so the choir has time off, and I think some of them took off this week, didn't they, Bishop? But I heard you really are. Really good. Thank you. And musicians, y'all play loud. I'm just kidding. I'm just kidding. But anyway, come on, sister, with the GBM announcement. And also BAL.
This is the last week to be able to donate to Greater Birmingham Ministries Food Drive. So if you would like to donate anything, I will be in the foyer after the service. And we are going to be delivering that this week. We've had a good, wonderful response. And for all of you that have given, I thank you. There's families that need our help, and they're going to get it. Also, if you pulled a name for a child's Christmas present, if you have bought it, they need to go in tomorrow. So we need to have all of those in. I think we probably do. I'm not seeing anybody out here that maybe have one that hadn't turned it in. So if you bought one, these are in-kind donations so that you can take it out for your credit on your income tax. If you'll pick up an in-kind donation form, they're out there on the foyer on the table. You can fill it out and send it in to Birmingham AIDS Outreach, and they will send you a letter back that you can use for your taxes. So they will be out there. And we thank everybody for the help with these 2 projects. It's going to make Christmas for a lot of people that we don't even know. But God knows that you are going to receive a blessing for giving. Thank you.
Yes, thank you. Absolutely. We're trying to feed 200 poor families Christmas dinner, partnering with other member congregation of Great Birmingham Ministry. And so we really, really appreciate your help on that front. Also, we invite you to join us on Christmas Eve for our Lights and Lessons, Carols and Communion service. It's a beautiful service with the readings of Christmas and a homily and Christmas communion together. We invite you to come and to be a part of that. It begins at 10:45 on Christmas Eve. And so we ask that you'd really come and be a part of it. You'll be blessed as you come and be a part of that. And also we invite you to join us on New Year's Eve for our New Year's Eve festivities that start at 7 o'clock in Danko Hall. We will be having we'll be having chili cook-off at 7 o'clock and grilled cheese sandwiches. And then at 9 o'clock, we will have our very popular bingo with prizes. And then at 11:15 in the sanctuary here for a special time of bringing in the new year with communion. And so we invite you to come and join us for that. Also, yes, did someone say something? While she's doing that, we want to say thank you to, last Sunday, I forgot to mention Latricia's name. They, and the wonderful job that the children did with the Wings of Worship, I wanted to thank her for the work that she did with that. And she does a great job with the children. Also, I wanted to say that Lighthouse, don't forget Lighthouse, it continues. We will be having it next Sunday as well. You had an additional question.
Today we are going at 3 o'clock to Spring Gardens, which is a housing development out off of Tarrant Highway. We're going to be caroling, and I know it's raining, but it is. They have walkways that are covered. So even if it's raining, unless it's coming really storming, we're going to do that today. We have prepared 160 gift baskets for them, or bags, with fruit and nuts and candy, and it should be really nice, a nice treat for them. So we need all the help we can get caroling. We have the words to the songs, but we need some voices that are willing to come and carol and go through Spring Gardens and hand out bags to people at their doors. So if you'd like to join us, 3 o'clock this afternoon, if you need directions, I would be glad to supply those to you. Thank you.
Thank you. Our board members on duty today is our first vice moderator, Cynthia Harris, the treasurer, Will Johnson. Our staff person on duty today is Deacon, where's she at? Right there in the door, Deacon. As our assistant senior deacon, Kay DeMint. If you have any questions, any needs, please see one of them. They'd be glad to help you in any way they can. Also, birthdays this week, little Taylor Salonic, boy, he's growing up, is 13 on the 17th. John Smallwood's birthday is on the 17th. Connie Watkins on the 20th. Dwight Casey, where is he at? Hiding over there. Dwight Casey's birthday is on the 22nd, which was my daddy's birthday. And Lena Dupree's birthday is on the 22nd. And so we want to wish them all happy birthday. I know a lot of folks are gone this week, but we're still going to be having reception after the morning for December birthdays. And this week, this month, is being done by the children. They are decorating cupcakes. For Jesus' birthday. So join us afterwards in Fellowship Hall, in Danko Hall, for that. Also, I want to say thank you to Jennifer and Tammy for preparing Wednesday night's supper. It was really delicious. Thank you very much. And also, we want to thank the Covenant Kids for the cupcakes and so forth that they are doing today. Amen? Decorating today. And praise for Joe Green got a new job. Amen? And P.J. Pear received a great report on her eyes, and we thank. And we're so blessed to have Mama Dorothy back with us this week after her little mishap. If you see William, slap him for hurting Mama Dorothy. I'm just kidding. The peace of the Lord be with you. Let us rise and greet one another in peace.
Please rise in spirit and stand as you're able for the singing of our processional hymn, Joy to the World.
Who has made us all brothers and sisters by his loving grace. Join me in praying our prayer of invocation. God, we come singing joy to the world in anticipation of celebrating the birth of Christ. Be in our midst as we worship today that we might be found rejoicing in the advent of joy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
On the two previous Sundays, we lit the Advent candles of hope and peace. Today, we light the candle of joy. God wants us to have joy. The angels who announced to the shepherds that Jesus had been born told them, "Do not be afraid. I am bringing you good news of great joy." Therefore, we light the candle of joy to remember that Christ brings new life and everlasting joy. In the season, help us prepare our heart for this gift of Christ. Help us to hear and do your word that we might be found rejoicing in the advent of joy. Therefore, on this third Sunday of Advent, we light the candle of joy.
Opportunity to receive in membership new members. Amen? And so today, we have Shannon Price and Monica Johnson, who wants to unite with us in membership. Would you come forward and face the congregation? Amen. I got this wonderful text message this week was telling me that I don't know if I've ever been in a church where I experienced having such an appreciation for my church and church family, and I thank you all for that wonderful text message. They send me little notes to uplift me, and I thank God for you. Amen? I'm reading what is familiar passages of Scripture to those of us here from Colossians, the third chapter, which says, "Let Christ's teachings live in your heart, making you rich in true wisdom. Teach and help one another along the right road with your psalms, hymns, and Christian songs, singing God's praises with joyful hearts. And whatever way you have to do, whatever work you have to do, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, thanking God through him." Monica and Shannon, and extending a cordial welcome to you as you are received into our Christian fellowship, it is becoming that you renew your profession of faith in Christ and your purpose to live a Christian life and to be publicly welcomed into the fellowship of this congregation. Therefore, in the presence of God in this congregation, would you repeat after me your profession of faith? "I acknowledge my faith in Jesus Christ and my purpose to live a Christian life, publicly declaring my engagement to cultivate the spirit of Christian fellowship and love, and to seek the welfare of this congregation while I remain a member." Will all the current members of Covenant please rise as you're able? Do you, the members of this congregation who are already on the obligation of the same covenant, welcome into our fellowship these sisters, and do you promise to encourage them and help them in their Christian lives? Would you respond? We do. Amen. Will everyone please rise as you're able? Finally, we read from 1 Peter these words: "Therefore, be calm, self-controlled people of prayer. Above everything, be sure you have a real deep love for each other, remembering how love can cover a multitude of sin. Be hospitable to each other without secretly wishing you didn't have to be. Serve one another with the particular gifts God has given each of you as faithful dispensers of the magnificently varied grace of God. And if any of you preach, then preach your message as from God. And in every way you serve the church, do it recognizing that God gives you the ability so that God may be glorified in everything through Jesus Christ." Monica and Shannon, with great joy, I welcome you into the family of Covenant Community Church.
Blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love, the fellowship of kindred love, is like to that of love.
You may be seated.
Children and young at heart, please come up here, please.
They took off after performing last week. I think your mic is gone out. Cut her other mic off.
Okay. And you know what? Today we lit the candle.
You want me to hold it for you?
Yeah. We lit the candle of Advent, representing the joy. What does joy mean? Who can tell me? Come on. Sure. What is joy to you? Happiness. Food.
Praise the Lord. Flesh and blood didn't reveal that one.
Good grades, maybe. Helping someone. You know, don't you feel good when you help someone? But joy is what comes from the inside. It's what you've been given to experience. And you know, we have a gift that was sent to us that brings us the greatest joy. Does anybody know what that gift is? Absolutely. What do you think I might have?
It ain't Jesus.
It's not Jesus. It's not Jesus.
It's a porcelain oven.
But it reminds me of physical, one that I can see of Jesus.
Amen.
See? And sometimes we need to look so we can see this is the season where we experience and we get to share and talk about the birth of Jesus and what he has done for us, because he is the one that gives us the joy. And do you know, there are many things in our life, or many times, we may not have joy. But we know that we can always ask our Lord and Savior to help us, because that's what he's there. He's our King of Kings, Prince of Peace. And the important thing is to receive him into your heart. And anybody can do that. We come as children, as adults, asking Jesus to come into our heart. And so I wanted to share something with you. JR and I have talked this morning. And in this world, we don't always have joy, but we know that the Lord will help us because things happen. And we had a little tragedy this week, and with children. And even locally at a hospital. And so we don't understand always why people do the things they do, but I know that the Lord, if everybody just had the Lord, how much a better place this would be. We wouldn't have such tragedy as we do around. So I know, as we're going to have a special prayer for our children that were that's no longer with us, but I want you to know that through this tragedy, that we can experience God's joy, because what we can do is be there for other people, to help them and to love them. And you know, I truly believe that the Lord's arms are around those little children.
Yeah.
And giving them the comfort that they need, and saying, you may not experience that joy on earth, but you have the greatest joy here in heaven with me. And I truly believe that's what the Lord says to those children. And two incidences that happened. And we had a local one here at the hospital this week. And it's all around us. But you know, we have the joy that the Lord gives us.
Yes.
And we need to be able to share that with all people. Pam?
I don't know if most of you know. I didn't hear about it this morning because I was away from TV and stuff all yesterday. But at St. Vincent's, we had a shooting and so forth. And one of the persons that got shot was the house nurse.
House supervisor.
Huh?
House supervisor.
House supervisor. When they responded, most of you probably know that Pam works there, and she would be one that would normally be responding as the house supervisor. And so I'm going to ask Pam to come and stand for the ones at the hospital, and I'm going to ask this little guy who I was at the hospital when he was born, come on, to stand in for the parents of those kids, and we're going to anoint them on behalf of those families and your family at St. Vincent. Zach, on behalf of all those precious little children, and also for those families, I anoint you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And Pam, on behalf of your St. Vincent's family, I anoint you in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come to you right now. No other help we know. And God, as the song says, if thou withdraw thyself from us, there is no place to go. And we come to you right now and we lift up by proxy Zach and our sister Pam. And God, we pray for those who have been killed and those who have been injured. And we pray that your Holy Spirit during this time will be with those families. We rest in your assurance that to be absent from the body is truly to be present with the Lord. But God, our hearts are broken. And so God, we lift up these families and we lift up these children. God, we pray that you'll repair the breach that has been broken. And that you, in the midst of all their difficulties, somehow will allow them to experience the joy of the Lord. Because we know he's able to sustain us during the difficult times. And so we lift them up and we thank you. In Jesus' name.
Just always remember, the joy of the Lord is our strength. As the children go to children's moment, back to you.
And let us continue with our worship this morning as we sing our praise chorus. Oh, come, let us adore him.
Tonight in the pastor's study, there's a group of us that gather for prayer. And by then, our prayer minister, Jamie, will have made a list with all the names and all the prayer requests. And we will take the opportunity to lift each one individually before the throne of grace. And then we take it with us and pray over it the rest of the week. You're always invited to join us. I'm glad to say that growing group. For a time of prayer. We're going to have to move out pretty soon. That's okay. I'm happy about that. Perhaps you didn't have an opportunity to make your prayer request known. Maybe yours is personal, and you just want us to remember you in prayer. If so, would you raise your hand? Let us go to God in prayer. From the cares that fret, the burdens that weary, and the noises that distract us, may they be laid aside. Here may the noise of the outer world be hushed as our hearts and our minds are lifted in worship and praise to God. Father, we come to you this morning and we come as your children. God, some of our hearts are heavy over the events of this week. But we still come because we have joy. And we know the difference between happiness and joy. Happiness is caused by circumstances, but your joy is constant in our hearts. And so this morning, God, in the midst of all the difficulty that's happened all around, the tragedy, nothing makes us happy about it. God, this morning, the joy of the Lord is our strength. And we come to you leaning on you, Lord, because we don't have any place else to go. And so this morning, God, we come and we ask for your blessing. We ask for your touch to every moment and every issue before you. God, you know what was already our prayer request. You know those unspoken requests as the hands acknowledge. But God, we still acknowledge them because we believe you're able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all that we ask or think. So God, we come this morning and we lift the people of this congregation. We lift those that are troubled in body and spirit. We lift the concerns of our community and the world and its leaders. And we lift our church, your universal church, and its mission. God, we come to adore you. For you alone are worthy. In Jesus' name, and all God's children said, let's worship the Lord this morning. The joy of the Lord is our strength.
For this third Sunday of Advent, joy is from Philippians 4, verses 4 through 7. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God will transcend all understanding, will guard your hearts and your mind in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put into practice, and the God of peace will be with you.
Please rise in spirit and stand as you're able, for the good news is from the Gospel of Luke, Luke 3, verses 15 through 18. The people were waiting expectantly and were all wondering in their hearts if John might possibly be the Messiah. John answered them all, I baptize you with water, but the one who is more powerful than I will come, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his barn, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. And with many other words, John exhorted the people and proclaimed the good news to them. This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Amen.
Glory be to the Sovereign and to the Christ and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now.
by night and nearly fell asleep. Another lonely, quiet night of watching all those sheep, until the choir of holy angels pierced the night with songs of joy. Good news I bring, for Christ the King is Mary's baby boy.
Mary was the first one to carry the gospel, and the angels brought the news of that precious little boy. Mary was the first one to carry the gospel, and that news brought joy, sweet joy.
Hosanna to the highest, and to Christ his only Son. God's glory wrapped in swaddling clothes, the meek and lowly one. Will change the hearts of all who can believe. What the prophets told has come to pass, a virgin has conceived.
Mary was the first one to carry the gospel, and the angels brought the news of that precious little boy. Mary was the first one to carry the gospel,
and that news brought joy. Thank you, choir. I know that a lot of my Scotty, you pulled something out of them this morning, didn't you? Amen. We're so glad. And what can you say but thank you to those wonderful musicians? Amen. Amen. Today is the third Sunday of Advent. And the theme for the day is, of course, joy. Today is actually in liturgical circles known as Gaudet Sunday. And the word Gaudet Sunday, or Pink Sunday really, but the word Gaudet is broadly translated from the Latin to mean rejoice. It's the Latin word that was used in the reading of Philippians this morning, where Paul says, rejoice in the Lord always. I'll say it again. Rejoice, the Lord is near. It's meant to emphasize the anticipation of the coming of the Lord and to know the joy of the Lord. So today is really, if you boil it down, Joy Sunday. And it's hard sometimes to have joy when you've had all the stuff that we've had go on around us this week. But we can have joy because the joy of the Lord is a fruit of the Spirit. It's not determined by what's going on in your life. You know, I'm happy if things are going well, if my circumstances are good. If they're not, I'm not happy. But I can have joy regardless of the circumstances. Amen? Because joy is a fruit of the Spirit, and today is Joy Sunday. But being pink or Joy Sunday means that Christmas is awful close. Matter of fact, it's only a week and a couple days away. I remember growing up what Christmas meant to me as a child. At our house, we the children would be up at 4 a.m. ready to dive into what Santa Claus had brought. Now, we knew better than to wake Mom and Dad up at 4 a.m., okay? And so we'd just sit there and we'd stare at those presents under the tree and around the room. And my mom had this weird and aggravating little habit. No matter how big or small a toy or present was, it got wrapped. Or it got covered by Christmas sheets. And we knew better than to look under them. Yet we did that one year, and somehow that old girl found out about it. It wasn't pleasant. We didn't do that again, if you know what I mean. I hate to think this about that saint, but I think it was her way of just giving us a little last bit of torture before Christmas actually got there. About 6 o'clock, though, we were sort of like y'all getting off from work. We became joy in motion. Amen? And we'd rip those things open, and we'd have such a good time. It was about joy. And so on this third Sunday of Advent, Gaudete Sunday, Pink Sunday, Joy Sunday. Very briefly, I want to talk to you. Did you hear that, James? About rejoicing in the advent of joy. Let us pray. God, we thank you and we bless your name. We thank you for the word that you will give today, and I pray that if I can help, you use me. And Lord, as David said in Psalms 19, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. For we pray it in Jesus' name. And all God's children said, amen and amen. Rejoicing in the advent of joy. I read the cutest little thing this week. It seems that in the hustle and the bustle of Christmas, this woman lost her handbag. And fortunately, a little boy, honest little boy, found it and returned it to her. And as she was looking in it, she went, I remember having a $20 bill in here. But now there are 21s in here. And the little boy said, that's right, lady. Last person I returned, the woman didn't have change for a reward. I think the moral of that story is he didn't want anything to interfere with his advent joy of the reward that was supposed to come by being honest there. Amen. But what does it mean, rejoicing in the advent of joy? Usually on this Sunday, with the two assigned lessons from the lectionary, we usually talk about John the Baptist, but this Sunday, I thought it was more important, especially after all the things we've been through this week, for us to talk about Paul's, the epistle lesson this morning. Because obviously for the Apostle Paul, what it meant was living with an upbeat feeling that nothing could destroy. Even though his life was like some of the events of this week, a series of just bad circumstances. I mean, his life as a Christian involved shipwrecks, beatings, imprisonment, unfair criticism. Sound like a pastor. But anyway, a whole host of other, just all kinds of tests and trials. But he never let it affect his attitude. He never let it affect his attitude. And that's very important for us to note during this holiday season, especially during this period from, you know, like Thanksgiving through Advent, through Christmas, through the New Year. It seems that this is the season of the year that has a way of adversely affecting our attitudes. Oh, we try to put up a good front. How are you doing? Oh, I'm just so happy it's Christmas. Really? That was about as phony as Undertaker's Get Well card. You know? But this season has a way of accentuating periods of loneliness and depression and low self-esteem for many in our community. Can you imagine how that's even accentuated by the events of this past week? How appropriate it is that the lectionary epistle reading for today deals with our attitude, because it is in our attitude that we will either wallow in misery or live in joy. It's all right there between your ears, your attitude. And so we find in the Apostle Paul never let the negative stuff, the negative forces in life, no matter what his circumstances was, and he had plenty of circumstances that he could have been under the circumstances, but he never got under them. He never let them affect his attitude. What was his secret? What did he have that you and I need in 2012 if we're going to attempt to rejoice in the advent of joy? He had three things, and I'm going to be really quick about this because I know y'all want to get to those cupcakes, okay? Number one, Paul sincerely believed in prayer. He sincerely believed in prayer. Did you listen to what Bobby read? He said, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your request to the Lord." I know a lot of us use prayer as, you know, a last-minute dish to save a dying ship. We only pray when we're in need. Lord, help. But if you had a best friend, how long would it be your best friend if you only talked to them when they needed something? Just a little thought. Amen? I mean, some of us go through the motions of prayer where prayer becomes this ritual, this mindless act of a conditional response. I heard Dick Van Dyke say, tell about a little boy that was dining with his parents and his grandfather, and after watching his father bow his head and speak some words softly, the boy asked his mama, "Mama, what did Grandpa say to his plate?" That little boy may be onto something. You know, that's the way some of our prayers are. They have no more meaning than praying to a plate. Amen? Prayer is meant to bring you into the presence of God. What are you going through? Not just when you're going through something. You ought to be talking to God all the time. Amen? For others, prayer is this attempt to manipulate God, to get favors from God. But you know, that misses the whole point of this communicating with God. If you want joy in your life, it starts with your prayer life. An authentic prayer is born out of a relationship with God, a deep relationship with that one who has created you. If you don't pray, when do you talk to God? And I teach, you know, in the membership class that you need to have a time of quiet as part of your time of prayer. Everything you say, you already know. You need to listen for God to speak to you. Amen? It means we learn to stay in the presence. You know, that's why I don't ever say amen at the end of my own personal prayers. I never say amen. I intend to talk to him some more that day. Amen? I don't get on my knees and pray at night either, because I've woken up the next morning like that. God knows I need sleep. I get into bed, and if I fall asleep talking to God, God knows it. You know I need to sleep. Amen? We make it so difficult. But prayer is what we need to do. We're not only supposed to make our request known to God. God wants to make some things known to you. Amen? Some of us just don't listen. We got that iPod in our ear. You see, it's through that prayer that you connect to all the source of all power, all love, all hope. Paul understood that rejoicing in the advent of prayer meant he started with that prayer. Paul sincerely believed in prayer. The second thing, and this is where many of us miss the boat. You know, it is so easy to go to the negative. You can be having this wonderful conversation and just out of the blue, you'll go negative. Anybody notice that? Paul didn't do that. Paul understood that you got to focus on the positive in life. You don't focus on what's gone, you focus on what's left. Amen? And listen to these memorable words from the text this morning. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent, if anything is praiseworthy, think on these things. We think on everything but those things. We think about who's done us wrong. We think about who we're going to do wrong. No, we don't really think about that. We just do it. But we love to relish in our misery. If something, you know, and let me give you an example. You know, occupational hazard of the pastor. You know, I stand at the door and I greet people when they leave and I'll get, you know, 150 wonderful comments. If someone says one bad thing to me, guess which one I remember? I bet you it ain't no different. Amen? James, do better. I'm just kidding. Amen. But you see, here's the point. You know, it may sound crazy, but I read something this week that's tragic, but a little humorous. It was a study a few years ago done that indicated that cities where country music is the most listened to sound on the radio, those cities have the highest suicide rates. Isn't that interesting? Those of you who are familiar with country music know it's usually about losing something. You know, they say spin it backwards, you'll get the dog back, the car, the truck, you know. My late friend, Dr. Daryl Mitchell, who was this phenomenal musician, used to say to us, country music is a tool of the devil to torture us good musicians. And I've just lost everybody in the room that's country music fans. Some could be lost. I'm just kidding. But you know, I've heard some good country music. It ain't all about losing. I hope that statistic is turning around some, or else I ain't moving to Nashville, I tell you that. But here's the point. You have a choice in what you're going to focus on in life. Let me just tell you that you can't stop crazy things coming in your head. You can't stop negative thoughts coming in your mind. But this, the old saying goes, you can't stop a bird from flying over your head, but you can stop it from building a nest there. In other words, you can't stop those negative thoughts going through your mind, but you can stop focusing on them. You can choose to focus on something else. And if you need a little help, pick up this book and go to Philippians. It's just a plain old feel-good book. You can read it in 20 minutes, even if you're a slow reader. Philippians is just a feel-good book. If you feel yourself, you can't focus on the positive, you go there and you read where it says, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if there's anything praiseworthy, think on these things. You begin to think on the goodness of the Lord. Amen? Focus on the positive in life. It's a choice. You have a choice, but is it going to be the negative that brings you down, that causes you to give in to depression and low self-esteem, or are you going to accentuate the positive in your life? You're still in the land of the living. You got it breathing this morning. Amen? You got a lot to be thankful for. Focus on the Paul said, whatever those things are, think on it. That's pretty good advice. Paul gained the advent of joy because he believed in prayer and he focused on the positive. Last thing. This is the thing that I guess we have to believe in, especially after this week. You trust that whatever happens, God is with you. Paul trusted that no matter what happened, God was with him. When he was out there on the ocean and that ship was going down and they were throwing things overboard to keep from drowning, it still wasn't working. Paul remembered that the Lord had told him not a single life on this ship was going to be lost. And everyone made it to shore. They were wet when they got there. They had to swim during the night to get there. But every one of them made it. And that taught Paul a valuable lesson. No matter what is going on in my life, no matter how bad it is, God is with me. It's what Jesus promised us. At the end of his life on earth, I know we're celebrating the birth, but when he was getting ready to go back, he says, "Lo, I'm with you always." How long is always? It's forever. And you see, we have to remember that God is with us. Later on in chapter 4 of Philippians, Paul writes these words in verses 12 and 13. He says, "I know what it is to be in need. And I know what it is to have plenty. I've learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all things through him who strengthens me." Paul knew that whatever happens in his life, he was going to be able to cope. Why? Because he wasn't alone. He knew that with him and God, that's the majority. I read a fascinating little study this week. It was about a 12-month-old baby. They took a 12-month-old baby and they put that baby at the end of a glass table on top of the table. And then they put the mama at the other end of the table, about 10 feet away. And mama was standing there with this beautiful little toy. Ferris wheel, I think it was. And they fixed the lighting control so that the glass looked invisible, although it wasn't. But it looked invisible to the baby. And it looked like the baby was standing on solid ground. And they had it rigged so that halfway between the baby and his mama, there was this illusionary look where it looked like the baby had come to a cliff. Looked like it was a deep valley. Wasn't, it was only illusion. And they were wondering what the baby's response would be. And when the baby crawls closer to midway, he comes to where he's looking at this cliff. It looked like it's a valley. And he's uncertain. On one hand, he's scared. Because at that age, I guess you have a natural fear of height. But on the other hand, he wants to get to his mommy and that toy. And so unable to resolve his ambivalence and his uncertainty, you know what the baby does? He looks at his mama to see what emotion she's expressing on her face. The organization that did this is called the Baby Watchers. And they call that social referencing. And when the baby doesn't know what to do, he looks at his mama and he takes the clue from his mama. If the mama has been instructed to show fear, that baby will retreat from that cliff and get very upset and start crying. But if the mama gives a nice smile, conveying the message, "You're doing fine, honey, come on," that baby will crawl right over that cliff that he thinks is a cliff and go to mama. As I read that story this week, I thought what a beautiful story it was of a life of faith. Some of you are at a place in your life where you need to crawl over the cliff before you to get where God wants to take you. And some of you need to know it's just an illusionary cliff. It's a trick of the devil. It ain't real. With God, you can do anything. Some of you need to look at the face of your mama, God, or your daddy, God. And you need to see that he's saying to you this morning, you're doing fine, come on. And you need to get up wherever you are in your life and go be with your mom and daddy. Whatever it is you need this morning, don't focus on the cliff of your life or the valley. You look in the face of God and hear that he's saying to you, you're doing fine, honey, come on. Paul could see in his heart his heavenly Father's face, no matter what cliff he faced in life. He knew God that was smiling at him, and he moved forward. That's how you rejoice in the advent of joy. All I've got to say to you this morning is, what about you? What about you on this Gaudete Sunday, this Joy Sunday? Will you move forward during this holiday rejoicing in the advent of joy? That's God's desire for you. And you can, if prayer becomes very real to you. You can if you keep your eyes focused on the pot. Let some of that garbage go. All it's doing is messing up your life. And you can do it if you look in the face of God and trust that God is saying to you, come on, you're doing fine. Paul said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthened me. I usually end the sermon with a nice little slow hymn. Of course, I love changing it on this Sunday because today is a Sunday of joy. What better way to say yes to the Lord than to think about, focus on the good, how great our joy. Let's stand and sing.
Whilst of the sheep we watch at night, glad tidings brought, an angel bright. How great a joy, great a joy. Joy, 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 joy. Praise be the Lord in heaven on high. Praise be the Lord in heaven on high. This gift we got, we cherish well, that ever joy our hearts shall feel. How great
and offering help support the ministries of this church. that others who come through those doors or hear about us through our internet ministry may come to understand the unconditional love of Jesus Christ. Would the ushers come forth and we give up our tithes and offerings.
Thank you.
tithes and offerings, that they may continue to be used for your benefit and your service in this community. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
On this third Sunday of Advent, the Sunday of joy, let us prepare ourselves for the receiving of the Holy Sacrament of Communion as we say together our general confession. Let us pray. God of Advent, we confess how great our joy in the birth of Christ Savior, Christ the Lord. Forgive us for our sins. In this season of joy, help us to truly rejoice in the advent of joy. In Christ's name, amen. We now pause to individually confess to you, Almighty God, those things that separate us from you, from others, and the best in ourselves. Let us join together in the prayer that Jesus taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. God's forgiveness helps us to rejoice in the advent of joy. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, know today that God has heard each and every one of your confessions. And my beloved, you are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. And amen. Would you join me in the liturgy of the great thanksgiving? God be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to God.
Let us give thanks to God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right, a good and a joyful thing to always and everywhere give thanks to you, Creator God. Therefore, we join our voices with the angels and all of the hosts of heaven, forever proclaiming your glory. Sing. Excitement of the birth of Jesus Christ, the great sorrow at his death, but our joy came on resurrection morning with a promise that regardless of what we have going on in our life, we'll never walk alone. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, called to the upper room to share a meal with his friends, he took bread and he lifted it to heaven and he gave thanks and he blessed it. And he broke it and passed it to him and said, Take and eat, each of you, for this is my body, which is to be broken for you. And likewise, at the end of the meal, he took the cup of Elijah, and he lifted it to heaven. He gave thanks, and he blessed it. And he passed it to him, and he said, take and drink, each of you, for this is my blood, the blood of the new and the everlasting covenant, poured out for the forgiveness of the sins of the one and the sins of the many. And just as often as you eat of this bread and you drink from this cup, you do these things to recall me into your memory. If you feel so comfortable, stretch forth your hands as we collectively consecrate these elements. Loving and gracious God, we ask that you send your Holy Spirit down upon these simple elements of the seed of the field and the fruit of the vine, so that they may become for us an ever-present reminder that joy came in the morning. Because they symbolize and they give us your life, your grace, and your love. If all this be in the holy name, you will pray. Amen. Let us join together in proclaiming the affirmation of the mystery of our faith. There'll be intercessors here at the altar following the morning service. They'll be happy to pray with you no matter what your need may be. Please avail yourselves to them if you need. This table has been set for you, and all things have been made ready. Won't you come as the ushers direct?